honestly, I was always that kid who kind of play fought in high school. I remember in science class, I would always sit in the back, and then me and my hockey friend would be playing like punch for punch on the arm. So I've always been interested in fighting. And then, yeah, one day a friend brought me into train, and I joined this gym called the Wamba, and I kind of stuck with martial arts since. I didn't have any intention of fighting. I just enjoyed getting a good workout, and then eventually my coach kind of pushed me towards competition, and then took one fight, and so on. I was naturally pretty good at it. Like, I started off with like amateur Muay Thai fights, and I just did very well. And like I said, I never intended to be a fighter. I still don't even consider myself as a fighter. I'm just a martial artist, and I've always enjoyed training. And yeah, I kind of took one fight, and you know, when you win, why wouldn't you take another fight? And I kind of just ramped up a bunch of amateur Muay Thai fights, and then next thing you know, I got offered to fight pro, and yeah.
All the fans that have been watching him on YouTube for so many years will be elated with that one. Jeff Chan showing himself to be the real deal on the biggest stage of all here at ONE Championship.
I believe a martial artist is someone who is always a student of the game. A martial artist doesn't mean you compete. A martial artist is just someone that you train. I believe martial arts teaches you so much. Like, martial arts has changed my life. It's given me discipline, it's given me self-control, it's given me fitness. Yes, it's given me a career. It gave me my fiance, because I met her at the gym. So it literally gave me everything. Money, wife, skills, hobby, self-defense, self-discipline, self-control, connections, friends, like a whole community. Like, it's given me everything.
Jeff Chan seminar, first day is my favorite day. Whenever we bring somebody in, we always do the instructors and, you know, the really serious students first day. That's what we're doing. Jeff's a pro fighter, so we're gonna move around with him today. Everyone's moving around with him Saturday, Sunday after the seminar, but the seminar that's open to the students and actually the general public too is 11 a.m. to 5 p.m. with an hour break. It's a long day of training. Super excited about Jeff the man. He's got over 1 million followers if you just add up his channels, and we're gonna move with him and get to know him a little bit.
James, the owner of New York Martial Arts Academy, reached out to me a while back and asked if I was interested in doing a seminar, and of course I was interested. He flew me out here on Friday. This would be my fifth time coming to New York. The four previous times were here just to fight, and we drove from Ottawa. So, you know, 8-hour drive really sucked. So flying in was a big game changer. Everyone at New York Martial Arts Academy have been great. Really good vibes, great environment. James is such a character.
Jeff! Where are you?
Everything's ready in your return?
Ready.
These are my guys. Nice to meet you. I'm Jimmy. Welcome to my home.
Beautiful.
Thank you, brother. Thank you. We're happy to have you, bro. We're super excited.
Cool.
Did you meet all the guys?
Yes.
Yeah, we're just waiting on one more for today. And like the rest is just like young kids. So
get
warmed up, bro. The place is yours. Waters. Would you like some water?
We are good right now.
Awesome, bro. Let me get changed up. I'm gonna hop on.
Perfect.
You met Teddy, Ramon. Don't let him meet you.
And James put me through 19 rounds of sparring.
What'd that feel like?
I felt like being put in the blender. And no, that was really cool. Really, really good.
Filmed some great content, really good guys. Everyone's very skilled, very controlled, intense. And, you know, I love it when we get that good footage because I'm all about creating content. I just love how the martial arts community work, and I love the people in it. Everybody you meet in the martial arts community are so respectful and so humble, and you just get along with everybody. And you know, like I said, sometimes it's very natural for two guys to have egos, and when we spar, we amp it up. And with me and Teddy, we're going pretty hard. He dropped me with a liver kick.
Jab! Liver!
Side kicks don't work.
And I head kick Alfonso.
Oh shit.
Sorry, man.
At the time, I'm sure he was like, oh, damn it. But right after, nothing but respect.
Sorry so much. No, you're good.
High five, hug, love you. And that's the thing about martial arts. It's just a special connection that you have with people. Just because I caught him once doesn't mean he won't catch me next time. A fight is a fight. A sparring match is a sparring match. Anything can happen. You know, if I fought him 10 times, maybe I win once, he wins 9 times.
It means way of the intercepting fist.
Gotcha.
I mean,
gotcha. Yeah.
I always thought there was two ways of pronouncing.
Kun K-U-N-E or not Kwan.
No,
I totally got it.
Yeah, it's okay. It's J-E-E-T space K-U-N-E space.
Okay. Yeah, that's what I thought. That's what
listen,
I thought.
Bro. It's very simple. We box, we kickbox, we wrestle, we use the weapon. Cool. And we've been doing it since 85. Before MMA came. Like, my dad like, he did Shudo before Jiu-Jitsu. He was the first guy to teach Jiu-Jitsu in Queens. Before that, they did like Shudo. It's like American wrestling. Yeah. It was like leg locks. It was a poor man's Jiu-Jitsu. But they had it. Like, grappling was in the curriculum. We were the first school to really teach adults, really teach grappling.
The vibe here at New York Martial Arts Academy is awesome. The vibe in New York in general is just lively. So many different personalities, and same with the people here. Not only were they super respectful and humble, but they all have personalities. They're all funny. James, the owner here, cracks me up.
Hold on, get out of the way. The champ is here. Get out of here.
Talks a lot. So funny, though.
This is the best pizza in New York. Joey's Pizza is one of my students. Joe, you're the man.
It is very good. Legit, it is very good.
And the thing is, you know, I'm talking a lot right now because I'm on camera, but I'm actually kind of a quiet guy. I'm kind of introverted. So he talks a lot, and I like listening, you know?
Your job is good. Yeah. So I shut it down a little, and then shoulders. Yeah, I shut it down. Now chest. Chest.
What do you mean
chest? Chest. Watch. Oh, shut down my jab. That's what I'm doing. I'm going bop. And you can't see it.
This doesn't move.
So watch. I shut it down. Chest.
That hurts.
Like, you have a nasty right hand to the body. You.
James is, I can tell he's very experienced. He knows his distance. He can drop his hands. He can play that game. So if you watched a bit of our sparring at the beginning, I was hesitant. I don't know if he was hesitant or just being respectful. You know, he's great hospitality and showed me nothing but respect. So with that said, when your opponent drops their hands down, you're not gonna just go and swing at them because you know that when you do swing, they're gonna try to counter. So both of us were kind of like looking at each other, faint to see if the counter comes. So we played around like that for a bit. And then eventually, you know, what he works best with it is in the pocket, just like Teddy.
Yeah.
So he gets in the pocket, throws a good bit of a body shot, and I try to respond back. And super good, super skilled in the pocket. Gave me a few good body shots.
That's good.
This is no different than just martial arts. MMA, all combat sports, all
are supposed
arts,
to end that way.
Yeah, all martial arts at the end of the day is all the same thing with a very, very small nuance. Maybe like the foot is a little bit more bladed, a little bit more squared.
Yes.
It's funny because like I was that guy too, where I'd be like, that martial art doesn't work. But
you're a Thai guy. Thai guy.
Yeah. But now that like I'm older, more mature, more open-minded.
What are you looking into now? Besides Muay Thai? More boxing?
So I started with Muay Thai.
Yes. And Thai's very good.
And I was telling Ramon in the car, I was like, I started with Muay Thai and I used to be like karate, taekwondo, doesn't work.
But wait.
Then, now that I started transitioning to MMA, watching Joy St. Pierre.
Distance control in karate makes sense.
Yes,
and that guy you move was real good. The southpaw with no hair, I don't, forgive if I don't remember his name.
karate guy with a really nice.
Oh, yes.
What a fighter,
distance,
brother.
The way karate manages the distance is the ability to fight with your hands.
That's
down.
What and the jiggy does have.
Now I'm trying to learn karate and I'm trying to learn boxing.
You're going
to
learn jiggy kendo. We're going to teach
you.
No, you're going to learn. You're going to learn.
And it's funny because I used to be like a boxer, an MMA. I'm gonna chop his legs. But now I fight with a very bladed stance. Mm-hmm. But as long as you know the rules, you can break them.
Yes.
Kick me all you want, I'm gonna dodge.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. No, your movement's good, bro. Your dart, your right hand, everything.
It's funny because I trained 3 different martial arts. Then I learned Jeet Kune Do, and I'm like, this is what I evolved into. And then Bruce Lee, he trains a bunch of different martial arts, and it's his no style philosophy.
Our stance is simply like this. It goes front toe, back heel, 1 inch off the ground, centered, knees coiled in. So you can pop in and out, and then you just transition into like a tai chi. Like you go back like heavy when you want to check.
Yeah, exactly.
Simple.
I'll back up. I'll check.
You'll back up
when I'm backing up.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Very we have a very similar stuff.
Yeah.
That's interesting. Very interesting. You ready to get back in there? Let's go.
Yeah.
So after 19 rounds, extremely tired, went out, ate, got some dinner, and then next day was seminar.
So obviously we're doing the Jeff Chan seminar. Everybody welcome Jeff. So obviously like Jeff is very skilled. You guys have all seen him on the internet. He's a pro fighter. How many fights in total?
About 25, 30.
25, 30 fights. That's a real deal thing. I had the pleasure of moving around with him yesterday. Thank you, Jeff. He's nothing but great work and you guys will see the stuff on the internet. But today it's about learning. Like always, respectful to our guests. If you have a question, he'll come around. And myself and some of the instructors are gonna be helping after I change up. So that's really all I gotta say. Just welcome Jeff and have fun with everybody.
Thanks for
what
making
I'm fairly confident about when I teach a new group of students, because I host camps around the world as well, is that no matter how experienced you are or how new you are, I believe and I'm confident that the stuff I'll teach will be of value and something new.
So look how big of a step I take off to the side. And I'm hitting with the lower shin. So I like to aim the bottom of my calf to my ankle. I've been starting to incorporate like karate into Muay Thai. So Muay Thai is like a lot of shin. Karate, they kick a lot with the foot. The benefit of kicking with the foot is you can bounce off a lot further. And I'm a lot longer. Whereas if I kick with the upper shin, boom, I'm much, much closer to being hit.
Because my style is very unorthodox, it's very different. I believe it's a style that was developed through my own training and of training with under so many different coaches and through training so many different martial arts. And the theme is the double step low kick.
So all the double step is I'm sliding my rear foot forward, shifting weight to my rear leg, then stepping off to the side in the fully pivoted position and chopping down at the leg.
It's a really strong method of getting in the pocket and exiting out of the pocket. I'm an evasive fighter, so I like to get in and I like to get out before I get hit.
I personally have been to many seminars and I find it's very hard to retain information from a seminar because the guy will teach several different stuff and then, you know, a month later you kind of forget everything. So everything is gonna revolve around this double step.
So I purposely make my seminars and camps so that you learn the double step and you're using that throughout the whole 2 days. We're working that double step low kick. So once you learn the double step low kick, you don't just use it offensively. There's so many ways to implement it. There's thousands of different setups. And basically we worked through the seminar on how to execute first, then using setups, then using it off counters, then using it off counter to the counter, and so on. Like everyone has a different approach to basic, and I believe that as long as you teach a student from the beginning and they get used to it, it's gonna become their basic.
He's really good. Jeff is a good fighter, well-spoken, and he's a good coach. He understands why the moves work and everything. That's why I brought him in. There's a lot of people that can fight, but he's a good teacher.
I believe confidently that I have a skill when it comes to teaching. I may not be the best fighter, but I do see the little details.
I throw my left kick at you.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Clear the leg, step back. So step see back. How you're very squared?
Yes.
Stay a little bit more bladed.
Sure.
Yes, good. Now from here, leap in with a gazelle hook. Boom, followed by the cross. Boom, followed by the double step low kick. Yes. use your shin to bounce off.
Try again.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, exactly. And now I'm going to try to hit with the cross.
I throw the cross.
Boom, 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 boom. There we go. Good. Yeah.
When I'm teaching a student and they actually want to learn from me, it's such a rewarding feeling. So seminars are the best, especially because I know that they're coming out of their way to join me. Like if I'm teaching at a regular gym and the guy doesn't really know me and it is their first time, it still is rewarding if they like it, but nothing is more rewarding than doing a seminar here, because now I got these people who already know me, who already watch my content and really want to come and learn from me.
Yeah, try to hit me. Just like that. The reason why I said try to hit me is because the more you commit, the more power you'll get from this. Like watch when I do it to you again. Look at my right hand. Like I'm going for the knockout. So the harder you throw the cross, the better power on the kick.
There's this student that came and he kept saying like, oh my God, I can't believe you're here. Like I'm so surprised, so mind blown. I told him like, I'm just a regular guy, but like I'm just as happy and mind boggled that you're saying that about me. Cause again, I'm just a regular guy.
Young boy, spar with Shockey over there.
After the seminar, James put me through another like 20 rounds of sparring with the younger ones now. These guys, Jeet Kune Do guys, they definitely spar and put in the hard work.
How old are you?
17.
How long have you been training?
14 years.
What do you love more than martial arts?
Nothing.
That's right.
Only nothing.
That's right.
Only a year old. Less than me.
Yes, to the body you need to do something. Exactly. Find the input. A little more pressure on Jeff. Don't worry about him. He's a tough kid. You can bang it to shell up when you need to, young boy. But don't overshell. I need more JBB. Pin straight with your shots. Point A to point B, exactly.
I can't believe he's 17 years old. I definitely wasn't as good as he was when I was 17. And, you know, I credited him to good coaches.
Shell when you need. Good job. There it is, Jeff. Put some on him. Put some on him, Jeff. Don't worry, Jeff. Put some on him. Good kid. Stop. Go knock him over there. Get him from the body guard. Don't worry. Good kid. Knock him. Shell up when you need. Frame out that shell. When he's giving you power. Where's my breaths? I don't hear breathing. I don't hear no fucking breathing.
Oh,
sorry. Time. One more, you two. One more. Breathing. We should get in your groove. You're better when you...
Yeah.
When you play with that confidence.
Definitely. Yeah, of course.
You do it with his hands up. When you start to be slippery fish. You're shelling too often. Like, shell, slippery fish.
If you're confident,
shell,
you know what you're doing. I think that's the best style.
Best style.
Yeah. Fight face. This is good for you. Nice. Our breaths are calm. Nice start.
Nice starting cross.
Nice. Yep. Shoulder rolling when you need. Slippery fish, young boy. Get back to slippery fish and get the shell. Nice left hand to the body. Pull it to the head. Don't let him take your real estate. Why are you running? Yes. Make him work on the inside too. Yeah. Make Jeff work on the inside.
Emmanuel, he's super talented, super good kid, very humble too, very nice kid. I really wish the best for him, and I believe if he keeps pursuing and if he decides to continue fighting, he'll do very well.
Ooh, good job. Really? Yes, Jeff, you make me happy.
Everything that James taught me is the exact same thing that I do. The only difference is in Jeet Kune Do, they use their strong hand in front, and that's not what I'm used to. I'm orthodox. So I'm actually interested now into training with my right side in front, and I'm pretty much doing everything that I already know. Obviously little nuances, side kicks, oblique kicks, which I don't do, but yeah, working with my right hand in front.
Fairly, yeah, JBD, back fist, straight leg, corkscrew, rear hand, yeah! Just do the JBD side.
The biggest thing that I realized here is a lot of people misunderstand Jeet Kune Do. When I first came here, I was very surprised at the style and just the skill and the movement, because I obviously don't know much about Jeet Kune Do, obviously prior to coming here, and all I've read about or have seen on TV is that Jeet Kune Do is, you know, Bruce Lee or Ip Man style, like Wing Chun. So I literally thought that everyone would be fighting like this. Little did I know that Jeet Kune Do is no different than MMA. It's, in fact, it's super similar to my style. And that's probably why James brought me over, just because what I teach is very similar to Jeet Kune Do. It's not Muay Thai, it's not karate. It's very similar to boxing, but they blend in side kicks, low kicks, high kicks, everything. So I literally consider Jeet Kune Do just MMA.
Yeah, like a little tip for everyone is if you're trying to learn a new tech, or say you learned new techniques today or yesterday, if it was new to you, don't do it on Sifu Raymond. Do it on someone that's you know is less experienced than you, and you've got to build your confidence. It's funny because there's always internet trolls, and they'll see my tutorials and they'll be like, this guy's like sparring this guy who's like not so good. It's true. If I just learn a new technique, especially head movement, or it's risky, I'm gonna try out someone that's not so good first. There's three types of people that you need to train with: someone better than you, someone at your level, and someone less experienced. Someone better, obviously, to challenge you, and then you learn from them when you get beat up by them. Someone at your level, when you're training for a fight, you want to keep your instincts sharp. It's a fair pace because you can go hard at each other, but you guys are at the same weight, same category, so it makes sense, and same level. That's for fight camp. Then you want to train with people less experienced because you need to beat up people to build your confidence. If you're only sparring better guys, I don't think you'll get better, because then your confidence decreases and you're like, you're just not landing anything. So you have to train with all three types of people.
We have to hit the body too, Shuggy. You're headhunting the whole time. He's gonna 360 block all those right hooks if you don't do anything. That's it. How old are you?
14.
How long have you been training in New York Martial Arts Academy?
Nearly 2 years.
Did you train before this?
No.
Speed on him. Speed on him, speed on him. Nice. Yeah, you little shit. Maybe Tyson. I need less energy though. I need to be breathing. You can't do that all day. Yep. Now back to the pace you're at. Stop, go. Don't just stop and get punched. Stop, go. He found your rhythm a little bit. Change your rhythm, kid.
Nice.
Oh, sorry. He headbutted your pee-pee right there. That's real JKD. Go to the motto shift. He likes to fight, yeah. Hit his body too, Jacob. Left hand to the body, right hook upstairs. Oh, shit, careful. Shit. Oi! Nice! There it is. Yeah, don't forget, you're still 14, bro. You're good, but you ain't that good. Nah, don't let him kill your confidence. Don't let him kill your confidence. No. You walk forward. Yeah. We're joking. You hit him to the body. Yeah. Breathing. Nice. Don't let him trick you. Pull out. He's figuring out your rhythm. Pull out, kid. Pull out on an ankle. Yeah. Don't mess around with him when he's already figured out your rhythm. Left hand to the body. His head movement is there, but you gotta stab the body. That's right. When the guy's head movement's real good, you gotta stab the body. There it is. There it is, Jeff. Put it on him. She's good. Don't worry. Time. Good job, kid.
So good.
Good working, man. Who has not gone with Jeff that's under 30 years old? How long have you been training, DJ, with us?
2.5 years.
2.5 years? How did you train before this?
No, sir.
Go. Tap gloves.
To the fan.
He's countering your first shot, so you gotta feint a little bit, DJ. You gotta feint a little bit more, draw his counter out, recounter the counter. Counter timing. Don't give up the real estate. If you have to shell, shell. If you have to shell, shell. Yeah. If you have to. Wait, where's my head movement? Yeah, where's my head movement? Right hand is a better weapon. Stay up, right? Yeah, he's trying to line up his right hand to you. He's smartly trying to line up the right hand. Yep. You could dart to your right. Just be careful. Yep. Ah, circle back. Wait, yeah. Now back him up. Yeah, you have him a little bit on the corner. Know where you are. Know where you are, DJ. Why'd you give up that space? You gotta know where you are better. Quarter turn to your right after you faint. Quarter turn to your right after you faint. Exactly. DJ, he found your distance, so change it. He's comfortable. You see his hands down? He's comfortable, so change your rhythm. Good hook.
Good round.
He's really good too for two.
He's tough kid. Tell he's very athletic.
Bro, you see his kid sprint? Remember the video you were showing me? He was the kid that was booking down the block. Good basketball player.
Hurt your toe.
I thought you broke your toe.
The last thing we need.
Kenny, how long have you been training? 3 years?
2 years.
2 years? How did you do martial arts before? You did Taekwondo, right?
Nope.
Nothing?
Nothing.
What's more awesome than Jeet Kune Do?
Jeet Kune Do.
What's more awesome than Jeet Kune Do? Nothing, right?
Nothing.
That's right.
More Jeet Kune Do.
That's right.
Watch that.
See, he's covering a lot of distance. You gotta block that. You can't just run from that. You gotta check that with your left leg. Time. Very good.
You know what you can do with him?
Take him down a little.
Yeah, take him down a little.
MMA's round. To the floor, referee's position, you still go, you get on his back, we go.
Kicks,
yeah, but like,
obviously be careful with him.
Oh, yeah. Watch. Yeah. Now remember, he's bigger than you. You don't necessarily want to shoot on those bigger legs, right? So you want to make him box, make him kickbox, work your speed, young man. And get out of the corners, you gotta know where you are in the ring if you wanna fight. You can't just float to the corners for no reason. Yeah, he's gonna try to march you down Thai style. Smart. Good. Where's my body shot? There it is. Aye, two. That's two. Nice.
And he does that.
Hit him with the hip and wizard at the same time. If he bends me, now he's gonna flare my legs all the way through. Look, he shoots a righty double, hip wizard. Right away. Get in on them legs. Level changing when you're MMA sparring. That's it. Nice draw, Jeff.
Don't give up. Circle. Limp arm out. Nice.
So, fake lift, double. You okay? It's okay. Your knee? Are you cramping?
Mm-hmm.
Keep going. You might cramp in a fight. Keep going.
Boy. Kid's good. Box.
He's fighting. Nice. Who has not gone with Jeff kickboxing that's young? 1, 2. That's it. Temi, wait. Let him get a break after this. He's gone 17, 18 rounds. That's crazy.
After filming some tutorials, went out for dinner again, and then day 2, another seminar.
Again, for those who are new for today, the double step is really highly used because it helps me close the distance or create the distance. So if I'm this far and I want to kick Emmanuel, I could easily close the distance by taking 2 steps. 1, 2, 3. If I were to take 1 step, there's no way I can jump far enough to kick. So by taking 2 steps, I can easily close the distance. 1, 2, and chop. 1, 2, and chop. So we're gonna do the exact same thing, but we're gonna exaggerate the motion. We're gonna start from afar and close the distance with that kick. Notice how there's air time. I'm stepping 1, then I'm leaping in the air, then I'm landing. Okay guys, 1, 2, 3.
I attended a Muay Thai camp in Thailand, and the host of the camp does YouTube for a living. So I was inspired by what he did, and he encouraged me, hey, you can start your own channel too, like, why not? So I literally started my channel from there. I actually used his camera to film my first video. So I listened to him, I started, and I actually kind of treated it as my martial arts diary, my journal. So if I learned something new, instead of writing it down, I would just film it, and then I would post it online. So over time, it got traction, and my way of vlogging my training is to film my sparring. It's literally like a diary. Like, today I did terrible, today I did well. And over time, people kind of really enjoyed watching my sparring, so that's how I kind of have this like playlist of sparring vlogs. And then I'll make tutorials as well, I'll break down my sparring, and now that I've developed some sort of a name, people kind of care about what I do, so I can vlog about my life, like, oh, what do I eat on a regular basis, or what's my training routine? Oh, I'm going to Japan today, you want to see what I'm up to? You want to see what gyms I'm training at? So that's what it's like right now. The only difference between me and a bunch of other people is that I haven't quit. If I stop making content, I lose. If I don't stop making content, I win. And if you're always making good content, it's gonna eventually pick up traction. And if you never quit, it's eventually gonna grow. And I tell this to everyone, you will only fail if you quit. but a lot of people don't have the time and patience. And I've motivated so many people, friends and acquaintances, to start their own channels. And they're all like super motivated at the time. And I tell them it's a slow grind though. Very, very, very slow grind. I tell them 3, 4, 5 months in, they all quit. They don't see the numbers. Even though I told them they don't see the numbers, they quit.
Look, I'm gonna take that big step forward as I throw a big hook. And look, I floated out. So if you were to chase me with punches, I got a lot of time to see the punches coming. Whereas if I come up here, I'm playing the game that I don't like. And this is the Teddy beat me up when we're playing this. So again, we're here. I'm on the outside. If Teddy tries to pressure forward, now I got time at least before he beats me up.
I enjoy training. I love training. I hate fighting. Training is completely different. When you're training or sparring, you're calm, you're having fun. When you're in a fight, something about the nerves, it just zaps you and takes out your cardio. So every fight I've had, I was gassed out before the fight even started. While you're warming up for a fight, you're hitting pads, you're tired. The nerves makes you sleepy. Some people get excited, overly excited. I'm the type that the stress just pulls the energy out of you and you want to sleep. So while I'm hitting pads, I'm like, fuck, I don't even want to fight. Then you get in the ring. Before I touch gloves, I'm already tired. So I'm basically fighting as if I just finished 5 rounds, you know? Whereas when you're sparring, you're fresh. And, you know, I wish that I could perform the way I spar. Unfortunately, you don't. And that's probably why I make a living from sparring and not from fighting. Amount of work and sacrifice that you had to put in fight camp. Like people who watch fights, they don't know that. It's so easy for them to be like, hey, just you should take a fight. Hey, I want to see you fight. And when they say that, I want to fight too. But like, you got to sacrifice a lot. And for me, my fiance hates fighting. I actually promised her that I would stop fighting when I met her. And I told her I'm a businessman. I'm in YouTube now. I don't fight anymore. I'm just going to teach and stuff. And I promised her I wouldn't fight anymore. But then when I was in that situation, I started my YouTube channel. I was like, hey, fighting can help me with the credentials. It can help me with footage, the experience. So I promised her one more fight. So I took one more fight. I won. And then I listened to her. No more fights. They offered me another fight. I'm like, no, I'm not going to fight. Then I started getting a lot of traction on YouTube. And because of that, ONE Championship, I assume, you know, ONE Championship reached out to me. And when they called me and offered me a fight and a contract, you know, most people would be like, hell yeah, I'll take the contract right away. I actually took 2 weeks before I made a decision. And when I was on the phone, I was like looking at her and I'm like, yeah, it's ONE Championship. Like, I wasn't even excited because I knew she was like, you better not accept it. And then on the phone, I'm like, oh, I'll have to get back to you. And eventually we made an agreement that, like, hey, it's a once in a lifetime opportunity to be fighting for ONE Championship. Let's take one fight at a time. So I take one fight and I won, did very well, boosted up the channel. And now I'm actually stuck in negotiations. Just like every promotion, the pay is not enough. And if I take a fight, I actually lose money because I'm now not making content. I got to travel to a different city to get the best training. My gym is great, but there's just not enough fighters. And I want to train with the best if I'm going to sacrifice, you know, all this time and energy and I want to win. I got to train with the best and I'm putting my health on the line. I'm sacrificing my body, my brain, my time, and to get paid change. Really, the amount they pay is not worth it. If I did not have a business, you know, I would be fighting for pennies. But fortunately, at the moment, I'm not in that situation. But you know what? There's fighters out there who that's all they do. Some love it, but some they need to make a living. So they have to fight. And it's kind of sad. Tons of fighters out there, even UFC fighters, they get paid nothing. It's crazy. And they go to war. And my fiance is right, you know, I can't be selfish if I'm going to be in a relationship. If I take a fight, I get brain damage, I get hurt, I break an ankle, whatever. She's the one who has to take care of me. When I'm at fight camp, I'm stressed, I'm tired, I'm grumpy. She has to deal with it. She has to cook for me. She has to take care of me, right? So I can't be so selfish when it comes to that.
I know it's like you're super, super fast, but that speed, did you build it up through the years, or you were always like that?
I think it's a lie if people tell you that it's like through their strength and conditioning program. A lot of it is genetics, but you can increase your speed through strength conditioning, but you can't go from like someone who's naturally very slow and then just like Raymond's a bigger guy, strong, built differently. If he does strength conditioning, he'll get faster, but he will never be as fast as me. No offense, I'm much smaller. My genetics are different, but vice versa. If I want to get into bodybuilding or just powerlifting or just go for that knockout and I do his workouts, I'll get stronger, but I'll never be his strength. So that's why being open and training with different coaches and just learning from everyone is very important, because every coach has something to offer. And a good coach is not someone who tries to take away your style and just give you what style he prefers, but he tries to tailor you to what your good attributes are.
So since he's longer, how can I compensate for the distance?
Oh, well, to be honest, I missed thousands of times with this guy. Yes. I tried to move on him. Right. At that time, maybe I wouldn't do it, you know? Or
you mean overcommit, come further in, right?
I miss, he pulls back.
Bang.
Okay. Yeah. Long people, man.
That double step low kick is not easy to do, and you guys were all doing it because of the details and the way he was doing it. We're going to bring him back. You guys want him back?
Yeah.
I want him to learn like authentic Jeet Kune Do.
Thanks for coming, guys. Really, really appreciate it.
If there's something that I feel makes me stand out between other martial artists, is that I have a lot of traveling experience. And, you know, people call me like this Ronin who travels to all these different gyms and dojo storms. Except I'm not dojo storming. I go there with utmost respect. But yes, I do travel a lot, and I've traveled all around the world, and I've visited gyms, and I've sparred with the best guys in the world, you know, so many guys, and I got to just move around with so many different bodies and see the culture of different gyms, and it really opens your mind to martial arts and the skill level and who's out there. I'm sure there's a lot of other guys who have also traveled a lot, but not many people do that. A lot of people stick with their gym or maybe in their city and cross train in their city. But just training at different gyms around the world is what I think gives me, you know, a little bit more up there.